It's hard to imagine running almost 35 kilometers an hour using just my own 2 feet. Like, that's car speed. That is not human speed. But that is how fast Jesse Owens ran during the 100-meter race at the 1936 Olympics, which he won in 10.3 seconds, matching the world record speed at the time. The upcoming film Race is about Owens, an African-American runner who earned a spot at the Olympics in Nazi Germany and then won 4 gold medals, even though the Nazis tried their best to stop him from competing at all because of his race. It's been 80 years. And at 9.58 seconds, Jamaican Usain Bolt's world record from 2009 has only shaved 7% off of Owens' time. But in other sports, like swimming and pole vaulting, over the same amount of time, the records have improved by a lot more. So why the difference? Well, one part of the reason these records get broken is that some humans are just better at sprinting or swimming or pole vaulting. But another big factor in breaking world records is science, namely the materials athletes use to help them do their thing. And some sports just involve more of that science than others. Sprinting, for example, doesn't have much of it. The physics of the 100-meter dash is pretty straightforward. You run along a track and try to travel 100 meters as fast as you can. Your speed mainly depends on how hard you can push off the ground and how quickly you can do the pushing. Runners move a little faster these days because track surfaces are a lot firmer. Owens ran on ash, and modern running shoes help with grip. But anything else is basically down to tiny improvements in running techniques, especially ones that let sprinters leave their feet on the ground for shorter amounts of time. That, plus incredible talented and dedicated athletes. So that's why the world record for the 100-meter dash isn't that much shorter than it was 80 years ago. There aren't that many materials involved that we can improve or re-engineer. It's just the human body doing its thing. Researchers think that we are actually closing in on what they predict to be the fastest a human could possibly run 100 meters based on the limits of what our muscles and joints can do, which turns out to be about 9.27 seconds. Swimmers, on the other hand, have gotten much faster over the years. In 1936, the world record for the 100-meter freestyle swim held by American Peter Fick was 56.4 seconds. In 2009, Cesar Cielo of Brazil swam it at 46.91 seconds, an improvement of almost 17%, and a record that still holds today. Part of that has to do with improvements in swimming techniques, but a lot of it also has to do with technology, specifically the materials used in swimsuits. They are important because there's a big difference between running and swimming. When you run, you hit atoms and molecules in the air that do hold you back. That's what we call the drag force. When you swim, water molecules are doing the same thing, but water is a lot more dense than air, meaning that you crash into way more molecules and the drag force is much stronger. So anything that reduces drag can help you go much faster, which is exactly what special swimsuits called supersuits are designed to do. They're made of fabrics meant to reduce drag, like by having little grooves that let the water flow around you more smoothly, so you move faster. To make you even more streamlined, the suits also compress certain parts of your body, basically turning you into a human tube. Supersuit technology made swimmers so much faster that the International Swimming Federation decided to ban them in 2010, but by then, swimmers had broken more than 130 records while wearing them. The new rules restrict things like what kind of fabrics the swimsuits can be made of and how much skin they can cover. But companies are already building better suits that follow those rules, so when it comes to swimming, humanity probably has plenty of record-breaking left to do. Then there's pole vaulting, another sport with slashed records, and another one that depends a lot on advances in material science. In 1936, George Veroff, an American, held the record for highest ever vault at 4.43 meters. French athlete Renaud Lavigny set today's record in 2014 when he vaulted 6.16 meters, 39% higher. Unlike running and swimming, pole vaulting is a lot more complicated than just getting from point A to point B as fast as you can. Instead, you take a running start while holding a pole, and then you stick that pole in the ground and use it to fling yourself over as high a bar as possible. The pole acts like a long, thin spring and helps turn your sideways momentum from running into vertical momentum when you jump. So the springier the pole, the higher you'll fly. In the first half of the 20th century, athletes used bamboo poles. Since they were relatively light and flexible, they did tend to break, though, which was both dangerous and a quick way to ruin a good jump. Around the 1940s, some athletes started to switch to steel or aluminum poles because they had about the same springiness but didn't break as much. Then, in the 50s and 60s, everything changed when companies started to figure out how to make good poles out of fiberglass, plastic reinforced with glass fibers. The plastic makes the poles flexible, and the glass makes them strong. You can bend some fiberglass poles almost entirely back on themselves and they won't break, which meant that athletes could jump much higher. Men's pole vaulting records slowed way down by the early 1990s, and the record for the highest jump has only been broken once since 1994. So it's possible that we are approaching the limit of how high humans can jump using fiberglass poles. But who knows, there could be some material out there that we haven't discovered yet that makes an even better pole vaulting pole. Thank you for watching this episode of SciShow, which was brought to you and inspired by the movie Race, starring Stefan James and Jason Sudeikis. Focus features is releasing Race nationwide in theaters on February 19th, and there's a link to the trailer in the description. Please click it.